numerous people have written in published sources about other people's prose, or occasionally just about prose in general, involving the passive voice, and have shown very clearly that they don't even know how to tell active from a passive. I want to give you a few examples of exactly that. Tim Lavelle has a BBC blog post about how to write about upsetting events like school shootings without being upsetting. We use passive constructions, he says. 5 girls have died. Not, the man went in and shot 5 girls. But 5 girls have died is not a passive. It's a simple intransitive clause. He doesn't know what a passive is, and yet it's crucial to the advice that he's giving. I heard Steve Inskeep interviewing a US Army general on National Public Radio in the USA, saying, let's put it in the passive tense. There was a ceasefire agreement in southern Afghanistan with some members of the Taliban at some time. But the passive isn't a tense, and there are no passive clauses in the example that he gave. I don't know what he was trying to get at, but he doesn't know what a passive is. Paul J.J. Payak, in a blog post about the presidential debates in 2008, calls President Obama's "there will be setbacks and false starts" a passive. Payak says he's spreading the responsibility around. He didn't say, I will have setbacks, I will be wrong. He used the passive voice. Well, no, he didn't. There is no passive in "there will be setbacks and false starts." Payak is apparently groping towards some way in which that is evasive, but it is nothing to do with use of the passive. Marie Murray wrote an article in the Irish Times called "Weapons of Denial," and she said, the passive voice is especially useful where apologies are required. Personal apologies for what people have done personally, because instead of having to say, I'm sorry, the passive voice allows a culprit to say, it is regrettable. Instead of saying, I made a mistake, the abstract term, mistakes happened, can be evoked. Well, neither it is regrettable nor mistakes happened is a passive. Whatever she's talking about, it's nothing to do with passive constructions. John Fine had an article in Business Week about a plugin for the Firefox browser called Spin Spotter that will allegedly identify rhetorical devices as passives, an algorithm that can spot your passives. Passive voice, he says, example, a story says bombs land without stating which party is responsible for them. But bombs land is an active clause with a simple intransitive verb, land. Nothing to do with passives. Here's another one. Charles Krauthammer in the Washington Post, once described as the most influential commentator in America, was talking about President Obama's apparently gentle treatment of Muslims. On religious tolerance, says Krauthammer, he gently referenced the Christians of Lebanon and Egypt, then lamented that the, quote, divisions between Sunni and Shia have led to tragic violence, end quote. Note the use of passive voice, Krauthammer says. But there isn't any use of passive voice. Divisions between Sunni and Shia have led to tragic violence is not a passive clause, doesn't contain any passive of any kind. Law professor Richard A. Epstein in the Hoover Institution wrote for the institution's journal Defining Ideas that instead of suggesting policies to reduce the impact of government on production, Obama reverts into a lament for the lost middle class. He notes that our economic engine has, over time, begun to stall. But his careful use of the passive voice, "the engine began to stall," conceals that he has no explanation of the ebbs and fall of the overall system. However, "began to stall" is not a passive construction. Nancy Franklin, writing in the New Yorker, commenting on fraudster Bernie Madoff's having said about his Ponzi scheme, "I believed it would end soon." He betrayed no sense of how absurd it was to use the passive voice in regard to his scheme as if it were a spell of bad weather that had descended on him. Well, although Madoff does appear to speak as if the possibility of his criminal misdeeds ending were independent of his own volition, "it will end soon" is not in the passive voice. Nancy Franklin doesn't know what's an active and what's a passive. A writing teacher at Boston University, complaining about undergraduates' excuses, wrote about a student who had sent in a plane ticket stub, accompanied by a breezy email. "Thought I would be able to return by tonight, but it does not appear that will be in the cards." And the writing teacher says, "I found the switch to the passive in the latter clause of that sentence to be extremely irritating, as if he were freeing himself from blame. If you're going to be absent, just own up to it like a responsible human being." So let's look back for that passive. "It does not appear that will be in the cards." That's not a passive. It's not even remotely similar to a passive in any way. All of these examples offer clear evidence that something's terribly wrong with the general educated public's view of what passives are, because nothing like a passive is being presented. Though you could say that each of them, in some vague sense, the suggestion is made that agency is not being identified, responsibility is not being located on the appropriate persons. However, when we go on and look for further examples, we soon find that you can't always account for it, however vaguely, in those sort of terms. Take the example of Brad DeLong, who's a well-known blogger, and lists in one of his posts uses of the passive that he says you can find in an English translation of a passage by Wolfgang Mommsen. He quotes, "the misfortune that befell Germany and Europe, the Reich had to face a superior coalition, the war turned out to be blah, 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 the situation that isolated Germany, it was above all the bloody reckoning." That's five examples, and not one of them actually illustrates the use of the passive voice at all. DeLong suggests there should be alternatives that focus more attention on agency. But what he proposes as improvements to these sentences are often radical restructurings. He proposes replacing "the Reich had to face a superior coalition" by "the German government struck first and struck at Belgium and France, creating the coalition of Russia, France, and Britain. It then fought." But the replacement is almost triple the length and has a new subject, "the German government," that's referentially the same as the original, "the Reich." Nothing about passive voice is the slightest bit relevant to the original example or the replacement. Completely baffling if you are genuinely looking for something about passives in there. A letter by Dave Bruce of Hoboken was addressed to the public editor of the New York Times about a correction to a Maureen Dowd column, And the complainer says the passive voice note that she, quote, failed to attribute a paragraph, end quote, seems to play down what actually occurred. But Maureen Dowd's column failed to attribute a paragraph is in the active, not the passive. And Dowd is clearly specified as the responsible party for the failure, so this has nothing to do with responsibility not being tied down. Perhaps the most worrying thing is that we find in handbooks for writers that the same sort of mistakes turn up again and again. There's a book called The Aspen Handbook for Legal Writers by Deborah Bouchou. And you can find in there the following. Most sentences that include dangling modifiers are written in the passive voice. Changing to active voice corrects the dangling modifier because an actor or subject is identified in the phrase that begins the sentence. Example, when a boy, my father changed careers, passive voice. When I was a boy, my father changed careers, active voice, actor identified in modifying phrase. Now, there is a sense in which when a boy doesn't identify a sort of the subject, intuitively somebody was a boy, but who? That's not given. But this is nothing to do with actives or passives at all. The BBC News has a style guide, which in its 2003 edition, now changed, I believe, suggested we should compare these examples. The first is in the passive, the second active. And the first example says, there were riots in several towns in northern England last night, in which police clashed with stone-throwing youths. There's no passive clause in that. The Canadian Press Stylebook is another stylebook for journalists, a standard usage guide for all journalists working in Canada. Under common faults, it says the following, active versus passive. Think of active verbs as power words, words that drive your sentences, keep the reader's attention and move her briskly along. Not the economy experienced a quick revival, but the economy revived quickly. What's amazing about that example is the economy experienced a quick revival is an active transitive, but that's the one that is being alleged to be a passive. There's another pair of examples. At first light, there was no sign of the ship. That's supposed to be bad because of it being a passive. It isn't a passive. It's supposed to be replaced by the ship vanished in the night, which, by the way, is not an active transitive. It's just amazing that people who are writing about grammar from the position of presumed authority cannot tell the difference between active and passives. There's a website called grammarist.com that has a section on active voice and passive voice, and it's, I think, the most baffling yet. It says, in the active voice, to is usually dropped from the infinitive. For example, in this sentence, the to is dropped from the infinitive to stay. He should stay in Reno where he belongs. If the same thought were expressed in the passive voice, the to would remain. I urge him to stay in Cable where he belongs. There is no passive in I urge him to stay in Cable. I have no idea what this particular site is getting at. There's a large corporation that has a style guide, and I'm not allowed to say which corporation because the person who wrote to me about it works for that corporation and was worried about being fired, I think. It says, use active voice rather than passive voice. Active voice is easier to read. Instead of we have decided, write we decided. Instead of we will be implementing a program, write we are implementing a program. This appears to be a confusion of having auxiliary verbs or having extra auxiliary verbs with the notion of being a passive clause. There are no passives in the examples there. The examples I've just been reviewing have this huge array of different kinds of construction that have been mistaken for passives. And they include predicative complements, like his health became impaired, or he was very sorry, or is regrettable, or was dead, or responsible for, and so on. Simple active intransitives, like bombs land, girls have died, mistakes happened. Active intransitives with infinitival complements, like turned out to be, began to stall, failed to attribute. And most surprising of all, simple active transitives that are alleged to be passives, like changed careers, experienced a quick revival, implementing a program, duties included, actions encompassed, misfortune befell Germany, face a superior coalition, isolated Germany, clearing the Senate Judiciary Committee, allowed this story over race to bury one of the more consequential weeks of Obama's presidency. Some of these are from examples I didn't even read out. But no folk rhetorical property, no sort of commonly understood rhetorical notion could possibly yoke together a diverse array of constructions like this. There isn't any generally understood notion that covers all of these cases. It's not as if I'm requiring that everyone should use the term passive to mean what I think it should mean. It's got a meaning that refers to something in grammar. And there isn't any meaning it could possibly have to cover the kind of examples that I have just picked out of the literature. What's going on is people having the fuzziest notion that passive is somehow clumsy, verbose, vague, or bad. So they see a piece of writing that they don't really feel that they like very much, and they just call it passive, in the hope that that's the right term for it. And this is what you find in a huge array of usage literature, that it's incompetent in addressing the properties of the text that it's trying to critique. And it's no use to you whatsoever if you're asking for advice on how you could write better.